Film Freaks' Top 10 Worst Movies of 2016 video. And here we're going to be discussing our picks for the top 10 worst movies that pissed us off to no end. And before we get into our list, we figured we'd go over some runner-ups that we had for movies that didn't quite make the list, but we included
came
them
close.
As... they came close to it, but we saw worse movies than those.
Yeah.
So... Starting with my number three for my
dishonorable
mentions is The Finest Hours. Now, with this one, I didn't really expect much with this one. I just thought it was going to be your typical disaster film. And the story kind of got me interested because it's based on the 1930s sinking ship that happened and involved Chris Pine's character who has to go after and search to have to rescue them.
Yeah. And now, it looked pretty shot in it. It was a Disney. It was a Disney movie.
Yeah, it looked interesting, but in the end, this movie turned out to be pretty bad because it was not horrible, but it was just boring as fuck.
Yeah, and I spent too much time on that love story, and I knew that was going to be its downfall when I watched a little bit of the scenes. I didn't see it fully, but man, it was just the chemistry was pretty bland.
It was, yeah, it didn't really feel any chemistry with anyone in this movie,
Chris Pine, even
he didn't really seem like he was really, his acting didn't really, he just felt very bland somehow, you know, and this is rare because I like him in a lot of films, but this one, he just really felt like a lifeless character.
Yes.
So, that's my number three as far as my dishonorable. for my second dishonorable,
You name them all the way down.
Okay, my second dishonorable is Dog Eat Dog, a film I was actually looking forward to because this film starred Nicolas Cage and William Dafoe in a film that looks kind of like a Martin Scorsese kind of film where these three guys are busting these house heists and everything, and they're criminals. And it got me interested because it's directed by the same guy who directed Nicolas Cage, or the same guy who wrote Taxi Driver. And he also directed Nicolas Cage another film called Bringing Out the Dead. Mm-hmm. So Paul Schrader, who is a collaborator with Martin Scorsese in the past. So it got me curious, and while I do like the visual style they use, because this movie mixes a lot of red, blue, and like kind of natural born killers look to it, mm-hmm. which is cool, but... man, this story was so disinterested into it because after about the first 40 minutes, I didn't give a shit what was happening. Like, it went into a direction that was so bad that I felt like I just lost hope for the movie after that. Yeah. And William Dafoe was awesome in the movie, but, I mean, in with Nicolas Cage as well, but even their performances couldn't save this movie. So, I put it as just a runner-up because I saw, it wasn't... like, it was bad, but I saw worse movies besides that.
Yeah.
So, and then my number one dishonorable mention I'm going to have to mention is Assassin's Creed. Talk about a film that I was actually looking forward to, but unfortunately, the movie ended up being like every video game adaptation where they're taking the core concept of the game, and while they do mix in at least better, as a better adaptation, it's average, but as a film... it's one of the most boring adaptations I've ever seen of based on a video game. And keep in mind, I've only played part of the first video game, so I might be missing some things from it. But that movie just wasted so much potential. And it's sad that, you know, we're still getting this trend of video game movies that are still losing me after they're taking the core concept of the games and not even doing anything with it and just making it very insulting to the gamers and insulting to your intelligence and basically pissing on fans of the games.
Yeah.
So that's my honorable mention.
Okay. My top three dishonorable mentions that came close to making the top 10 list, but I've seen a whole lot worse films. I'm going to start with my third one. That is Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Out of the Shadows, the second installment to Michael Bay's adaptation to the Ninja Turtles, which the first one, it was not as disappointing, but it was... this is why I don't like Michael Bay taking classic stuff from our childhood and destroying shit. So, I was really looking forward to the second one, mostly. The first one, I was kind of iffy, whatever. So, I went and seen the first one, and, you know, it was not great, but it was not horrible. It was very extremely forgettable. I was really looking for this one because we finally get a live-action Bebop, Rocksteady, and Crane. And I was really looking forward to this. I went and seen it. Talk about fucking disappointment. You get, CGI is just everywhere.
I know.
You get the Michael Bay staring sideways at the ass of fucking Megan Fox. So he's doing the same shit from Transformers again. He's making the same mistakes again. You bring Bebop Rocksteady, and they remind me of those fucking two idiots from Transformers Revenge of the Fallen. The two rapping.
Yeah, Mudflapping Skids.
Yeah, so you get Bebop and Rocksteady now, and you can't even enjoy their characters because they're so fucking cringy. It's like, oh man, this is painful. Not to mention, you get Crane, you get him in like the last, you get 5 minutes of him.
Yeah.
And he is really CGI. I mean, this movie is like worse than CGI, like in Transformers. This is beyond CGI. So you get that horrible. You waste Crane for 5 minutes. Then you get that dumbass doctor who's supposed to be leading to Mayfly.
Or
Steve Urkel.
Tyler Perry.
Tyler Perry, but I call him Steve Urkel.
Master Stockman.
He's actually acting stupid. This is like, they're acting like a dumbass. And we're supposed to lead to believe he was something big.
Yeah. He's supposed to lead into Baxter Stockman, yeah. the fly.
So we're supposed to lead into the fly, and we're supposed to believe that, okay, Crane and. Oh, let me mention this. They really underused Shredder, where he doesn't even wear his fucking uniform.
No, he doesn't even wear his mask.
And
right when he does put it on, Crane puts him away and pushes him aside. I'm like, what the fuck was the point of putting him in the movie?
Yeah, like, he really didn't need to be in this film because there's nothing that Shredder is part of the story. He's really not. He just jumps out of nowhere.
Yeah.
He just comes, he sporadically just pops around the movie. I'm like, man, this is fucking just terrible. So that's, I don't want to spend too much time because this is a dishonorable mention, so that's my third. My second one, he just mentioned it, was Assassin's Creed. Talk about a film, I actually did doze off 3 times in this film. It was this fucking, I was really looking forward to this. I could not believe that one of the most anticipated films of 2016 ended up being so freaking boring.
Yeah.
This movie was boring. That was my problem. It was just extremely boring. I didn't really care for any of the characters.
No,
I could not get invested. The story was just so drug out. What were some of the issues that we had in that?
The fact that the structure was they kept cutting back 80% to the hospital scenes instead of the Spanish Inquisition.
So it felt like a Shutter Island film.
Yeah.
Because they were in this damn hospital mostly. So we're not seeing like the Spanish Inquisition, which I enjoyed, but that's like 10 minutes.
Yeah, Now, I understand from according to gamers that at least in the first game, it was a mixture of both the hospital and the Inquisition because it kept cutting back and forth. But the difference is that if it's trying to present itself as a film, I feel like it needs to spend more time in that Inquisition part and kind of maybe a few scenes here and there cut back to the hospital. And that way it can be closer to the games because it's hard to adapt something like that to a video game if you're just going to keep focusing on that hospital the whole time.
So, yeah, that's my two dishonorable mentions now. My one that came close to making the list because this movie just annoyed the piss out of me. I understand it got some fans of this, but I'm sorry. I was not a fan of this at all. It was an annoying piece of dog shit. It was Pop Star, Never Stop Stopping.
Yeah,
I'm really starring SNL's
Andy Samberg,
famous SNL comedian. And talk about, oh my god, this movie had me pulling my fucking hair. This dude, I mean, this shit was more cringy than, it kind of reminded me a lot of Malibu's Most Wanted.
Yeah.
And I wasn't a big fan of that film, but it was still doable. Not this piece of shit. We get a lot of scenes where he plays this rapper who's going down, they're kind of pulling a, I don't know if you ever seen him get him to the Greek.
I've seen bits of it.
It's basically, you know, you're on your downfall, and some guy steals his music. One of his teammates decide to go big and take his music. And then you get Andy Samberg trying to find his way back into fame. And he's singing songs, and they don't make sense. It's trying to be raunchy. Like, he's like, he has a song called Suck My Dick, Suck My Dick. And he's doing that, and the people actually bite into this and think this is funny. It's not fucking funny. It's juvenile humor. Like, farting, pissing. And then we're supposed to laugh at Andy Samberg's being stupid, like where he misses the basketball hoop, and everybody's like doing that, and they're like, "Oh!" I'm like, man, this movie just—I don't understand some of you people. I mean, if you like it, cool, but I don't understand. You know, you guys got weird taste in comedies, in my opinion. This shit. This, all right, I'm not going anymore because this is a dishonorable mention. But yeah, this movie was a colossal fucking mess. Not unfunny. SNL. It felt too SNL-ish. For me, and SNL today sucks horribly. I can't. They need to shut it down.
Yeah, I agree, man.
I didn't like it, so yeah.
All right. Well, now we get to our actual top 10 list, and for starting out with my number 10, I have a film that I saw in the theaters called The Choice. Now, I went into this film not really expecting much because I was with my ex-girlfriend Kelly at the time, so me and her watched it because it was a romance film. So I went into this thinking that, you know, it was going to be just, it is what it is, your typical romance film. But oh no, this was a lot less, and this was like really just piss poor writing left and right. I like Teresa Palmer, and I think that she can be a decent actress, but in this film, she is like one of the most stuck up characters I've seen in a romance film that, like, and this is obviously based on a Nicholas Sparks novel. So for those of you who like those kind of movies, fair enough, I respect your opinion and all, but this was fucking boring to me. And plus, it's insulting because you see a lot of scenes where the main guy in the movie, he's basically trying to get Teresa Palmer's character's attention. And throughout the entire film, them two obviously have boyfriends that and girlfriends that they're with. Well, at least Teresa Palmer's character has a boyfriend who's a doctor, and he's away in. And this entire movie, they spend a majority of them both cheating on each other. And it's like, I really couldn't get into their fucking characters. And plus, there's a plot point that's unresolved because we never find out. There's a plot point coming in the film where Teresa Palmer is learning about being a veterinarian. And they never even resolve that, at least from what I remember. So they leave that out of fucking question.
Yeah.
And the movie was just, I didn't buy their chemistry at all. They had a lot of very awful dialogue and I just couldn't get into it. So, long story short, I really didn't like The Choice. It was really, out of the Nicholas Sparks movies that I've seen, I'd rather watch The Notebook and Walk to Remember over this any day. So, yeah, that's my number 10.
Yeah, my number 10 was a reboot to a very personal movie I love so much. We all do. It's a classic. And, God, Ghostbusters. Oh my God, where did I start? I know a lot of yous like it, but I'm sorry. I'm gonna have to be biased. I'm gonna try not to be as biased because I did go into this film not being biased because I love the original. I do have a very soft spot. I do love two. Yeah. And oh my God, man, I'm sorry. These women did not do a very good job at all.
No.
Melissa McCarthy didn't. Rest of them didn't. If you want to see a film where Chris Hemsworth's worst performance, where he's actually playing the secretary, that shit was fucking retarded. Him playing a retard, like, hey, what's this? But remember?
Yeah, I remember that.
What's that Shark Tank? And playing retard, like a dumbass.
Yeah.
It's like, I feel like Paul is playing political games with this film. Say what you want, but he's being political with this film. And I think that was the downfall right there because they actually throw a lot of stupid lines that's against white people, men mainly. This is a feminist pushing movie. You can tell. And that's what ruined it. I'm not saying I'm against, you know, women or all that. I would love to see a woman in Ghostbusters. They just picked the wrong people. And Paul, they picked the wrong director too, man, because he's too political with his shit.
Yeah, and his, I feel like, besides The Heat, and I've only seen parts of a little bit of Spy.
Spy was his
best.
I feel like
he pushes too much political humor that's overdone.
Yeah.
And he pushes a lot of raunchy humor that I'm not a big fan of. Like, The Heat was good, but I mean, from what I've seen of Bridesmaids, I just really felt like it wasn't clicking too well.
And then the long drawn out jokes with Melissa McCarthy We're just carrying on that same joke.
Yeah.
They do that throughout the Ghostbusters, this whole freaking movie. They carry on jokes that lead to nowhere, that ain't fucking funny.
Yeah.
Like the scene where the, what were they talking
about? They're talking about the
movie. They were talking about a movie.
Oh, the, I forgot. It was after, well, it was
when she was drawing out that famous, Tony Montana, the name's from...
I think it's from Scarface.
Scarface, where they draw... I can't remember, but... Yeah, that's why this movie is so terrible. It's so forgettable that I'm glad I'm forgetting scene for scene, because it was a colossal mess. CGI was crap. I didn't really get into the plot. I thought it was a slap in the face of the original to kill them all off and just make fun of the original guy. Though I did like Dan Aykroyd. I did like... They respected him, but I thought they disrespected Bill...
Yeah, Bill Murray, I felt like, you can tell in scenes where he's in, he doesn't want to be there at all, because he was contractually obligated to do the film as a cameo, or else, you know, it would have been, he probably would have faced like a lawsuit or something.
Yeah. The girl who's in SNL, the black girl, what's her name?
Leslie Jones.
Leslie Jones, and the Spangler wannabe.
Kate McKinnon.
Kate McKinnon was probably the worst of this film. They're, oh my God, Leslie Jones really, man... She did use this to her political advantage, which kind of killed it.
Yeah.
Because she was sitting there making, oh, it's because I'm black. Oh, it's because I'm a woman. Oh, because I'm black. Oh, because I'm a woman. Ah! And screaming throughout the film.
Oh, my God.
That shit was just like, oh, my God. And then, Kate McKinnon, she was not funny. She was trying to be like a raunchy, dumb, like, scientist, like, farting all the time. She farts all throughout this film. It's not funny. This is what's wrong with comedy. And you do get a lot of Saturday Night Live, like Pop Star, you get that Saturday Night Live feel to this film.
Yeah.
It's like a skit. It's a one big skit. Horrible skit. That's what it feels like.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if you like it, that's cool, but that's my opinion. It's terrible. It's my number 10.
Alrighty. I definitely agree with you there.
Yeah.
My number 9 is The Forest. Talk about a film that, of course, this film came out in January last year, and I didn't expect much with this movie. I watched it to kind of catch up with my list of movies I missed last year, and going into it, I didn't really expect much, because from the trailers alone, you're getting exactly what you have, a typical PG-13 jump scare fucking movie every scene for scene, and that's what this is. And the girl who's played off there, Natalie Dormer, I'm sure she's fine on Game of Thrones, but here in this movie, she is the most fucking unemotional bitch that I've seen in a film in so many, in any type of scary movie. I'm sure, you know, she's a great actress and other stuff, but here, her character was just so bland and so unemotional that I just could not get into what she was doing. And the fact that the film spends the majority of time with her looking for her sister, it doesn't, I mean, it has a cool twist at the end, but it feels like it's everything you expect from a typical horror film that's PG-13 and not the good kind of PG-13 horror film. And now, the forest looks good itself. Like, I like how it looks authentic and everything, but it's just a piece of shit. So that was my number 9, and I don't recommend The Forest.
Okay. My number 9 was The Forest also.
There you go.
Yeah, I agree with him. The main girl, she plays... Her character is extremely bland. It's just blah.
Yeah.
No emotions, no nothing. She's just blah. Like, she doesn't even want to be there. Like, why did you sign up for this project? But, yeah, I'll get them. The only good thing is the forest looks pretty neat, and it's literally cinematography good looking. But, man, yeah, I didn't even get into the story, because they spent so much time just camping and just walking around.
Yeah.
And just seeing the most stupidest jump scares, where they're trying to jump scares.
Yeah.
Where the ghosts, like Asian ghosts, being on one side, dead body, and that stuff. I'm like...
That's what I'm saying. Like,
it's like, man, this movie's just straight boring. I mean, I can't really go into other detail other than it's fucking horrible. It's boring. It's just... It's drawn out. It just feels pointless.
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. Like, it's exactly the type of movie that will come out usually around January. And it's... Besides that twist ending, I didn't really have anything else to really go for it.
Yeah, so my number 9 is The Forest.
Alrighty, and now my number 8 is The Fifth Wave. Now, this is going to be a debatable with me and him, because he actually gave this film a lot more praise than I did, because I watched this film, and I was, from the trailer, I was like, you know what, this might be interesting. I go in, because basically it surrounds a force of, like, an alien life form or something that's taken that's coming in like these different waves, and they come across the world, and for the first four waves, they're doing like all these different disaster film tropes that they use, like floods and hurricanes and stuff like that. And then they basically don't spend enough time on it because the rest of it deals with the people involved that are trying to, the young survivors are trying to stop these aliens. So it got me curious in the trailer, but in the end, I found this movie boring as fuck. This is really one of those films that it had potential going for with its story, but they spent a lot of time with characters that I didn't give a shit about, and Chloe Martel is just trying in the film, and so is Liev Schreiber, or how you pronounce his name. Yeah. They at least did good. And I do like some of the twists that they have with the way that the aliens come in these different forms and stuff. Mm-hmm. So I do like that. But my biggest problem is that the film just, the action sequences are really shitty in a lot of scenes where they're not, they do scenes where they're doing a lot of quick cuts and a lot of shots. And I felt like the story didn't, it felt like I was watching, and I get that the film is based on a young adult novel, but it just felt like I was watching more of a Hunger Games knockoff than it was like something else where, you know, I'm trying to get into the story, but all this shit that keeps happening with these different characters that come up, I just didn't care about. And plus, that ending, and yes, I realize the movie's supposed to stand up for a sequel, but as far as the climax itself, that has to be one of the worst endings I've seen in a first movie leading up to a sequel. So yeah, I really didn't like the fifth wave. I thought it was dull, and I mean, I'm glad you like it. I'm glad some people other like it, but I just couldn't get into it. So that was my number eight. All
right. My number eight is the Buddy Cop sequel, Ride Along 2. I'm talking these are the type of films that are ruining the buddy cop genre right here. Ice Cube, I like him. I grew up watching Fridays, loved him in that. Some of the barbershops were decent, I liked. But I think at this point now, he's just playing the same guy every film.
Yeah, it feels like it. He's always playing a cop
in
a movie.
Yeah, in every movie, or, you know, he plays the same, or some the same gangster guy.
Yeah.
The same, you know. I thought this one, I did kind of like the first one. It was not strong. It was not I didn't really like it. It was okay. It was borderline okay. This one was just straight fucking terrible. And this is probably one of Kevin Hart's most unfunniest movie. Like, he's just straight up annoying in this whole film. He's like a little chihuahua barking throughout this whole film. And this is like a cheap January release type, February release type film. So you get the cheap CGI comedies.
Yeah.
And you see, I mean, this looked like Baywatch CGI. It was that fucking bad.
Yeah, we all know what that trailer showed in there.
Oh, God, the CGI is just terrible. And the most unrealistic shit happens throughout this whole film. You know, they're playing the cop where they go down to Miami to stop this big drug dealer dude.
Yeah.
Same shit. I mean, that we see it all the fucking time. How many comedies are you going to be with two buddy cops that travel to another city to stop a big drug dealer? It's the same shit.
That's what I'm saying.
It's not fucking funny. It's not funny. It's that stupid humor that I think we're going to see in Fistfight.
Yeah, that does not look good.
Yeah, but Ride Along 2, that's not worth watching. That was really boring. Crap fucking comedy. It's CGI'd from hell. The action is just your typical cheap comedy action film. It's just, there's nothing good about this. And in fact, they need to stop the Ride Along movies because they're getting terrible as they go.
Yeah.
So my eight is Ride Along 2.
Alrighty, fair enough. My number seven is Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Out of the Shadows, which he put on his honorable list, but I'm putting this on my fucking worst list because this to me was very just, it was the most annoying film that I've seen of the Turtles since probably the third one, which I saw bits. I haven't fully watched them, but for the little parts I did watch, that one was pretty bad too. So this one, I feel like, was even worse than the third one. I mean,
it's the worst Turtles movie.
So, because I actually didn't, I was kind of looking forward to it with the fact that they were bringing in new characters, like you said, Bebop, Rocksteady, and Krang. And yeah, this one, it pissed me off so much with them. And, like, the little funny parts I did have with them, it was overshadowed by all the stupid exposition dialogue that made no sense. Casey Jones was pissing me off even more.
Oh, yeah, Casey, I didn't mention him.
Yeah,
yeah.
Stephen Arell, or I don't know how to pronounce his name. I'm sure the guy, like I said, I'm sure the guy does fine on Arrow, but here, his character was such a fucking whiny punk.
And he's a cop,
and he's, in a way, he is the same equivalent to Chris O'Donnell in Batman and Robin.
Yes.
He is that annoying.
Funny to look like, too.
Yeah, and plus the action scenes, for the little that they had, they don't spend enough time with the turtles actually doing hand-to-hand combat, with as much as them doing like a bunch of jump scenes where they're doing skydiving or, you know, doing parkour shit.
Yep.
So, yeah, this is, to me, I didn't really grow up with the turtles that much. I played some of the video games and I played with the action figures, but I wasn't like a hardcore fan growing up. But to me, this film, even as a film standpoint, it's just so annoying and just, it pissed me off to no end that I hope that if they ever do another Turtles in One, just make it a fucking regular CGI. Don't make it live action. If that's the way you're supposed to do in the future. Kind of do what TMNT did, but kind of make the story a little bit better. I mean, from what I heard from TMNT. So do something like that or just stick to practicals. You know, that's really that's the thing to probably do. So, yeah, I fucking hated the Turtles, and that's my number 7.
Okay. My number 7, and I'm probably going to get a lot of controversy for this, but I'm sorry, it is my opinion. This movie was extremely fucking terrible. I don't know why people like this film. It's Swiss Army Man. Oh, my God, man. Where did I start? All right, guys, I get that it's an artsy film, and it's supposed to be quirky, and it's about two friends who can build a relationship, and they feel like they can't, you know, they feel like they're outsiders.
Yeah.
I get the symbolism it's trying to say, like, where you can actually find a friend where you can do anything around. You can fart around. You could say stuff that you're afraid to say to other people, and you got this friend. Basically, it's Paul Dano. It stars Paul Dano and Daniel Radcliffe, and Paul Dano is stranded on, I'm not going to spoil it, island. Not an island, but yeah. He's stranded. We're assuming it's like Castaway. And he sees Daniel Radcliffe flow up into the shore. And he's supposedly this zombie dude. Not really
kinda
zombie.
Like Weekend at Bernie's.
Weekend at Bernie, where he's not really dead. He is dead, but he's also symbolizing, like, some kind of friend, like, somebody that he can feel comfortable. I can't really explain it. I wrote a written review on it, but basically the whole film, it's really like a film that's not making sense. I understand that it probably symbolizes stuff that I didn't understand, but still, I just don't get into the whole film. Daniel Radcliffe is catching boners. He's farting. He's dressing Daniel up in like a girl, and they're trying to like, he's trying to teach him to what he's trying to explain to him the girl he has a crush on. So they play dress up. It's weird film, man. Some of you enjoyed it, but my problem was I felt cringy. I felt uncomfortable with watching some of this stuff. Like, I felt like, that's creepy. And they actually make out and kiss.
Yeah, it's...
Weird. It's becoming, like, Brokeback Mountain through this film. It's like... Then they... Later on, they find out he's not really on the island and all this stuff. But then, you get this really just weird ending where Daniel Radcliffe just farts and he just starts acting like a fish going in. I don't get what it's fucking doing. It's a weird film. It just feels like it's basically showing you now that it's okay to just blob things together.
Yeah.
Which is dangerous because that's generally what screws movies up. When you don't make sense, you just throw it out there. I understand that these two people, the directors, are best friends and they're kind of quirky and like to have fun like that. I respect for the people that do like it. But this is my opinion. I didn't like it. I thought it was just one big glob of useless mess. And it's about nothing about farting, boners, gay relationships, and being weird.
Yeah,
I mean, that's not me. That's not my taste of movies. So it's number 7, Swiss Army Man.
Yeah, I might check it out someday, but you know, I'd have to really, if I had the time to really take a look at it, I might check it out. But
I was actually looking forward to it. I thought it was going to actually, I did give it shit first, but then I was like, you know what, it looks fun. So I gave it a try, and it was like I thought the first time. It was not good. It was shit. So, you know, I praise for y'all like it. Every, you know, it's to each their own, but it's not my film. So, 7, Swiss Army Man.
Fair enough. So, my number 6 is Ghostbusters. As not trying to repeat what he said, but yeah, this is probably one of the worst reboots that I've seen in a long time. Like, Ghostbusters, the original, is a classic for me, and growing up, it was always one of those films that I can go back to for its comedy and its special effects and the story involved, and just the chemistry the likable characters and everything. This one, I had no hopes for it, and so after seeing it, it was worse than I thought it was going to be. Now, keep in mind, I don't mind the idea of a female Ghostbusters
film. No, I don't either. I think it's a good, clever idea.
Yeah, or you could even do a mix of both, like the original cartoon series did, where you have both male and female
working together.
But it wouldn't have been a problem if they had better actual comedians that were women. You know, if they wanted to do an all female Ghostbusters film.
CNL people that's on CNL today are not funny. They're terrible. They're too political, and they're just horrible, and they're unwatchable compared to the SNLs back in the 80s, which they didn't overdo political shit. They were just fun and funny.
Yeah.
And they're likable people like Bill Murray, Dan Aykroyd, so on and so forth. I mean, they keep going.
Well, yeah, and it doesn't help that this film is the potential they would have had if they ever made a Ghostbusters 3. I would definitely love to see if they ever would have made it before Harold Ramis unfortunately passed away. I would have loved to see that.
Yeah.
And the story they probably could have went with this new one, I probably would have been down for, you know, if I was actually interested in what was happening. Because every scene that I had to put with these annoying characters, and not just the main four, but the other characters like Chris Hemsworth.
Hemsworth's worst performance.
Yeah, and even the boring fucking villain they have that's supposed to be turned into the Ghostbusters logo, that to me was just really just null.
It was stupid.
Yeah, and so, besides the visual effects, which I thought were good, and 3D was really awesome.
And seeing some of the classic people.
And that's in the fact that it's actually the best 3D movie I saw in 2016 on a 3D perspective. Mm-hmm. This film, to me, shows that Hollywood just doesn't care. They'd like to make money off of films and that are old classics and reboot them to make money. That's it. And thankfully, this is actually the first time I've seen a reboot. Well, it's one of the few reboots I've seen that actually lost a lot of money.
Yeah, 70 million.
Yeah, I mean that. I know it has nothing to do with it, but I'm just saying, like, if they're trying to make a franchise of this, there's no way this would ever get a sequel based on that alone.
No, and Paul needs to leave because he's too political with his movies. The only movie I thought he did good, other than Heat, was Spy, because he didn't do the political shit. Then he decided to do it with this one, and he fucked it up. So
yeah, and it just doesn't help that I feel that the entire cast had no chemistry. The story, what little that would have had, was so wasted. And to me, I've forgotten about it since it came out, so I've moved on to other movies. But even still, this is to me one of the worst reboots that I've ever seen. So that's my number 6.
Okay, 6. My number 6 is The Boss, starring Melissa McCarthy and
Peter Dinklage.
Peter Dinklage, and basically it revolves around Peter Dinklage and Melissa McCarthy being together, and he fucks her over, steals everything, sets her up for fraud, she goes to prison, she gets out, and she's trying to redeem herself, and she redeems herself by starting a Girl Scout thing where they can fund cookies and stuff like that. And it had the girl from Sarah Marshall.
Kristen Bell.
Bell in it too. This is why I'm really getting burnt out on Melissa McCarthy. This film was painfully unfunny. It was stupid raunchiness. Her same ego that we've seen in Tammy.
Yeah.
But not as overdrawn as Tammy. But still, the comedy was just as bad. And at parts, I mean, even though I hate Tammy, I actually thought Tammy was a little bit more better than this, because this film was not only painfully unfunny, but this movie was boring and unfun. It's a bunch of girls, Girl Scout cookies. That's all it really was.
Yeah.
And the lady, Melissa McCarthy, trying to redeem herself and use, you know, acting like she's like this big ego badass at the beginning of the film was annoying. Just shows that her ego in this film is just beyond, like, she thinks she's in something that's really good and she's not.
Yeah, it is.
And it is painfully, I don't know what else to describe this film, so that's my number six, The Boss.
Well, and that's the thing, because I actually thought about watching The Boss when I first seen the trailer for it, because yeah. I was like, you know what, this might actually not be too bad. Then I was hearing him review, I was like, well, I guess I'll probably have to wait till video on that one.
Yeah, a lot of people didn't like it, and I agree, it was with everybody, it's got a huge dislike, and I agree with all of them, it's really a terrible film.
Fair enough. Yeah. Well, my number five is... this is going to be one I watched, but you haven't seen. Collateral Beauty. You talk about a film. Now, keep in mind, I already heard the buzz going on with this movie, but I wanted to go check it myself just to kind of see what the movie was really about. Because from the trailer, it makes you think that it's supposed to be kind of a Christmas Carol kind of film, where Will Smith plays a guy who is dealing with some personal issues, and he writes these letters that are for time, love, and death. And basically, when he writes these letters, he's under the impression that there's these... From what I got from the trailer, it seems like there's going to be like these spiritual people that come to him mm-hmm. as those themes. But boy, was I fucking wrong, because this movie was not only insulting, but it's one of the most mean-spirited films I've seen in a long time. This film deals with, the whole plot is basically Will Smith, and I'm going to spoil this, so for those of you who haven't seen it, I'm sorry if this is going to be a spoiler. For those of you who haven't, for the whole plot, okay, well basically, Will Smith plays a guy who has lost his daughter, and the whole plot is he writes these letters, and the trailer was very misleading, mismarketing, because it turns out in the actual film, instead of those three, like, spiritual people, whatever, they're actually actors. Edward Norton and Kate Winslet's characters, they hire actors to go to him, and they make it to where they're talking to him, and they're actually paying people to keep their mouth shut, so that when they actually get the footage of him on video, they're going to edit out the parts where it shows them on video, and it makes it seem like he's going crazy, to get him fired. That's the entire fucking plot. And it's very insulting, because not only do you make those characters unlikable and so, like, very insulting, but the direction is very sloppy, too, because they're delivering their lines in the most cringiest dialogue I've fucking heard in a long time.
Yeah.
So, this film, I just hated every single second of. It was... The only one I thought was really trying the most was Will Smith and Kate Winslet, because the rest, and I'll even say the... I'll even say Helen Mirren, too, but other... Than that, like, everyone's performance was just so bad. Like, you really don't care about the story, what's happening, and it just, you really feel like you just want to fucking punch every character that's on screen besides Will Smith because of the shit they're doing to him.
Yeah.
So, that's my number five, which was Collateral Beauty.
Okay. My number five, which, other than Poltergeist, was one of the worst paranormal films I've seen in my life. The Darkness, starring Kevin Bacon.
Yeah, I heard that one. Oh my
God! We get pretty much a knockoff to Poltergeist, where this guy they go to this Indian burial ground, they screw up this kind of set rocks and whatever, and they wake up the Indian ghosts and all stuff. Basically, like Poltergeist, they're on the burial ground, and then it follows them to their house. And basically, this movie was just fucking terrible. Like Buddy's performance was flat beyond repair. Like, even the boy was fucking flat. The ghost? What ghost? I mean, see, it looks like a goddamn... What's that one cartoon where, like, it was like dog prints everywhere? It was like, and he'd take dog prints off. It was like an old school cartoon. That's what it reminded me of, a paranormal version of that, because it's just a bunch of fucking... It looks like dogs, like prints, hand prints and dog prints everywhere. It's like this ghost, and all he is just a black glob. And he just jumps. And Kevin Bacon's performance, oh my God, his acting skills was bad in this. He was like, huh? What do I do?
Oh man.
I was like, God, dude, what the hell was wrong with you? Then he goes to this world and he's like, do I get to sacrifice myself? Or some shit. I couldn't understand. Then he's talking, and then they're like, what's going on? And then his dialogue with the wife is just terrible. They're just, these lines are just, like, just blob. It's like an unexperienced writer wrote this film. It's just like a bunch of just dialogue. They overdraw, like, the scene where they go to they eat at dinner. They actually draw that scene out where they're ordering pizza, and they keep ordering pizza, and they just talk about pizza, and I'm like,
oh my God.
I'm like, God, dude, this movie is just fucking terrible. I had a hard, beyond hard time finishing this film.
I remember you telling me about that.
But, yeah, other than the Poltergeist reboot, I love Poltergeist. The reboot last year was terrible. This is probably next to as the worst paranormal film other than Unfriended I've ever seen.
I bet you, man. And that's sad because Kevin Bacon was in a good paranormal movie with Stir of Echoes.
Stir of Echoes, I loved him in that. But it's like his acting kind of went kind of dull.
I know. It's like, just crazy. I
guess taking so many breaks and doing crappy independent films. But he came back in Patriot's Day.
Yeah.
So. But, yeah, that's my number five, The Darkness. Terrible film. I highly don't recommend it at all. Don't watch it. If you do, good luck, man.
All right. I hear you. Mm-hmm. My number four is, it's basically an anime film that somehow got released here in theaters, but was supposed to originally go to direct video, and that's Norma the North. So my number four was Norma the North, which is basically about Rob Schneider playing a polar bear who goes to America to do some real estate plot. Yeah, because that's something for kids. That sounds like something for kids, exactly, doesn't it? And so, or to stop a real estate agency from building their land on Antarctica or wherever. Yeah, because when I think of an animated film, I think of that kind of plot. And so, oh my God, I didn't go into this movie with any expectations. I was just watching it, you know, because I just happened to be catching up with a lot of films. This film was so bad with its animation, you could tell it was shot cheap. Because every scene, when it shows, like, the frames of the animation, you can tell it looks like it's not even finished in a lot of parts. Mm-hmm. And the sound doesn't even help, too, because there's scenes where people are talking, and it's almost like the sound is ADR'd, because it would cut to an immediate scene where you hear, like, someone's voice, and it's not even the same person. Or you see, like, a building or something in the background, and you hear people talking over. So they do a lot of ADR that's not matching up with what's happening. Not to mention, a lot of the voice acting was terrible, too. And especially the animations, the villain they have in this one, he's voiced by the same guy who played off The Hangover,
Ed Helms?
Leslie Chow.
I remember seeing him.
This has to be the most, like, really stereotypical villain, because in the film, the anime film, he's constantly moving his hands up and down to get you the idea that he's a bad guy. I'm like, okay, so that's supposed to be really dumb. That's dumbing down for kids right there, because I'm pretty sure kids would know that he's a villain without having to do this shit the whole time. Mm-hmm. You know? Yeah. That annoyed the piss out of me. And another thing that pissed me off, these little lemmings that they have, too, were, like, so obnoxious. They're supposed to be, like, the minions of the movie, kind of. They're, like, the little sidekicks or whatever. But they annoyed the piss out of me. Every scene was them either pissing, farting, or doing all kinds of obnoxious humor that...
It's the same humor as we're getting in all these other comedies.
Saying, but I mean, there's other comedies that are that are animated films that don't have to rely on that kind of humor.
Yeah.
But this one, this is the most cheapest humor you can imagine.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
It's Rob Schneider, dude. He's getting worse and worse.
I don't know. And so, yeah, this was one of the worst animated films I've seen in a long time. And
it's funny when this movie was coming out, where they did the interviews with these actors that's in this film, and Rob Schneider act like he was sitting on a gold mine with this film. I was laughing in the comments in there, because this was like, people went back after seeing the film and commented on his video and just making fun of his ass. Like, yeah, you act like you got a gold mine here, dude.
He's like, I got a great movie you should go check out.
Yeah, oh, he was praising the shit out of it. But
yeah, that's my number five, sorry, I'm losing my numbers here. That's my number four, which is Norm of the North.
Okay. My number four was a movie that did not need a fucking sequel, let alone this took, 15 years to make? Zoolander 2.
Oh, God.
I wanted this movie to be number one so bad, but unfortunately I had so many bad fucking comedies, bad movies this year, that it got lucky. But it's actually, you could pretty much safely say that my worst film, second worst film, third worst film, and fourth worst film were all a tie at so bad of films. I didn't know which one, so I just picked randomly what I thought was a little bit better and what was worse. This movie did not need a sequel. So we get Zoolander, star Ben Stiller. You get people like Billy Zane. You know the movie from the first one. It's basically kind of like real life actors playing themselves.
Yeah.
I couldn't remember much of the first one.
I remember it was him and Ben Stiller and Wilson having to stop Will Ferrell's character.
Will Ferrell's character. So Will Ferrell comes back as the same villain, getting out of prison. Kind of has like an Austin Powers type thing feel to it, but a whole lot worse. And Ben Stiller's trying to be more relevant again. Zoolander's trying to be relevant because he's been forgotten.
Yeah.
And basically, him and Owen Wilson are trying to come back together into coming back to the Zoolander. And this one focuses on a lot of fashion, like they did the fashion clothes.
Yeah.
A lot of stuff. So it's doing that shit again, dude. But man, the comedy is so hair pulling. Oh my God. It's so painfully, extremely excruciating, unfunny. It's comedy is just like stupid jokes makes no sense, you know? It's being stupid. It's stupid comedy. It's like, you know,
Zoolander. Oh, my God.
And he's overdoing this shit. He's trying to do that shit again. And I think the first one was okay. I've never been a big fan of either of these films, even though Zoolander is praised a little bit and it worked for its time. But I think that this movie is heavily outdated, because it's still relying on that time period again. But it's 15 years later?
About 15 years.
Yeah, 15 years since the first one. So it's really, they're trying to stay relevant of that time still, of what was going on that time. They're still trying to keep that going.
Yeah.
It doesn't work. It does not work. Ben Stiller performance, everybody's performance was just flat zeroed in this film. No, it was not funny. The fashion thing, the stupid, I think that Sacha Baron Cohen's in it, didn't he?
Benedict Cumberbatch.
No, Benedict Cumberbatch, yeah. And he looks fucking weird in this film. And he's like playing a transy looking guy. I'm like, oh my God, and he's even painfully weird. It's like, it's uncomfortable. It's uncomfortable weirdness. It's like, ugh. This movie just, I don't know what else to say. It was, because it didn't have much of a plot, really. It was the same shit. You're hashing the same shit from the first one. It's the same storyline again.
Yeah.
Terrible. I highly don't recommend it. Zoolander 2 is my number 4.
Fair enough. My number 3 is, this one, I pretty much already called from the trailers. Well, I was kind of going into looking into it, but at the same time, I was like, well, I'm sure it can't be worse than that other one he did. 50 Shades of Black. So with this one, of course, every now and time we get a parody movie, of course it's going to be either A, it's going to be using the same jokes that are outdated, or 2, it's going to be relying on pop culture shit that really is so, it's going to be outdated later in the future. Mm-hmm. So this film, of course, is written by and starring Marlon Wayans, and you have a spoof of 50 Shades of Grey. Now granted, 50 Shades of Grey in itself is already unintentionally funny, so trying to do a parody could probably make it funnier, but no, this makes fucking 50 Shades of Grey look like Oscar, like actually legitimately a well-done, crafted story and making a straight romance that you would actually get into. Mm-hmm. This one makes it to where you take 50 Shades of Grey and just basically hash scene for scene for scene for
and
scene.
Just make
and
it just fun.
And run the jokes so bad to the ground, you're thinking to yourself, like, why am I watching this? Like, seriously, I could be watching other films right now.
Mm-hmm.
And this has the most obnoxious comedy I've ever seen in the film of Marlon Wayans in his spoof that he's done. Because I didn't really care too much with A Haunted House, but I still had some parts I enjoyed with that one that he did. Man. I still thought that one still had some funny moments. But this one, other than one joke that got to me toward the end, this film had was so annoying and had the most shitty jokes and very the main girl in the movie plays the Anastasia. She was so annoying, obnoxious. You want to tear your head off. And another one too that I hate was not trying to insult anyone, but the fat girl that's in the movie who's the best friend of her character, I wanted to pull my hair out. She was that obnoxious, man. Every scene when she said a line, I just felt like, man, I feel like I'm Malcolm McDowell and Clark Orange and my fucking eyes being plicked open. Like, yeah. Every time I seen her, I was like, shut up!
Yeah.
And another thing, too, is that it's like, why even spoof 50 Shades of Grey? I mean, they're... Every scene they are in, it's literally just the same joke. And the only thing they add is dick jokes, penis jokes, or S&M jokes that are really, you already see a mile away coming. Mm-hmm. And they're just not funny. Like, you watch this and you feel like your brain is being, like, destroyed after watching it for so long.
Yeah.
So, that's my number three is Meet the Blacks. Or, sorry, not Meet the Blacks, 50 Shades of Black.
Yeah. My number three was... Mike and Dave Need Wedding Dates. Oh, man. It stars Zac Efron. Oh, God. That one dude. Oh, my God.
Something Divine or whatever.
That Adam Devine?
Adam Devine?
No, that's a singer.
Well, it also had Anna Kendrick.
Kendrick and that one girl that we're starting to see a lot
of. Audrey Plaza.
Audrey Plaza, which is, you know. But she's... a good actress, and Anna Kendrick is a good actress, and it's got Zac Efron, which I do really enjoy that dude in comedy. He's done really funny films. I really like Dirty Grandpa. I know it was really hated, but I enjoyed him.
I did too.
But he is so great in the Neighbors series 1 and 2. So I thought, hey, you know, he's got a good stretch of comedies. This one should be good. You're talking about a movie filled with all annoying fucking characters, like straight, like, I've seen bad films, and then even bad films, there's a character that didn't annoy you, but this movie, just like everybody, their acting, their comedy is like scratch your fingernails and going down the chalkboard.
Yeah,
and that dude, that boyfriend, I can't think of his name, Divine,
or something,
Ben, I can't remember the dude, he plays the brother of Zac Efron. Basically, the story goes, is Zac Efron and his brother are partiers that ruin a lot of main events, like weddings and stuff. And their parents are pretty much saying for them, their sister's about to get married, and they said they're not invited unless they can get in a relationship. They think that they find a girl, they won't go whoring around and acting stupid, and they'll be more tamed. So they go on this thing where they go on Craigslist and take pictures of themselves and basically... looking for girls, and that's when Anna Kendrick and Plaza seen them and then hit them up, and then they want to be invited to the wedding, and, you know, you get your typical comedy where, like, you know, raunchiness, where the brothers, he's trying to really capture, copy Steve Stifler. He's trying to do it, and he does it in the most annoying fucking way. This dude is fucking stupid, and he's got that kind of voice, that certain voice. You ever hear an actress or an actor has a voice they use, like, where it's kind of like, it's so high-pitched and so, man. Yeah. You want to do that? Anna Kendrick actually does really fucking horrible in this film, because she's actually playing a ditzy retard who likes to run into shit, plays stupid, say that, you know, they throw her a mathematician, 2 + 2 is... is it sex? Huh? And Audrey Plaza plays annoying ass, like she's like a whoreness.
Yeah.
And her one-liners are really just, they're dull. They're painfully unfunny. And then Zac Efron, you can tell he doesn't want to be there. And it's so noticeable that his acting is subpar to zero in this. He's just throwing his lines like, yeah, and he's throwing potty humor like, yeah, and he's also trying to play a straight face too, where he's so annoyed to not want to be funny in this, where his character just turns into a straight face guy where he's not even, like, trying to throw a joke or anything. He just doesn't want to be there.
I can tell, yeah.
It's just, you can see it, and there's only one thing that only laughed at, and that was the part where this Indian dude was giving his sister a massage, and she was having all these orgasms and stuff while he was just touching her, and he does a scene where he's like rubs his butt on her butt and she goes, ah! I will laugh at that. That did get me, but that's the only thing that's funny in this film because I begged my girlfriend to turn the shit off. It was so fucking terrible. I almost couldn't get through it. So that's my number three, Mike and Dave. Need wedding dates. Do not watch this fucking film. If you do, whew, good luck, man. It's hard to get through.
I hear you, man.
Yeah.
So my number two is the same one that yours is, number two, Meet the Blacks.
Mm-hmm.
So talk about a film that when I saw the previews, I didn't even know this movie was even coming out until about a couple weeks or a month before. And this film, when it came out, it like came and fucking went. It didn't go hardly anywhere in theaters.
Yeah.
And so when this movie came out, I kind of got kind of curious because it's basically a spoof of The Purge where you got Mike Epps and his family moving to the suburbs. Yeah. And on paper, it might sound interesting, but this film has the most stale jokes that I've ever seen in a comedy. Not to mention, the whole film looks like it's playing it so straight. I couldn't even tell it was a fucking spoof.
Yeah, it does play almost like it's straight, and it was my number two, so we're going to kind of do a co-talk on this, because Meet the Blacks is my second worst film of this year, so yeah. Mike Epps, I love him. And I was really want to see this because he makes, you know,
he is a funny guy.
Funny guy, but yeah, this movie did not work at all.
No, I mean, he wasn't even trying in this movie. Every scene he was in, he was trying to say something that was supposed to be funny, but I'm just like, it was just so dry, so fucking dry, and so, like, I didn't laugh. I was sitting there just in agony, like, I don't care. Like, I'm seriously not feeling nothing with this movie.
And it's hard to get through. It's like, you gotta watch this. This is one of the movies that actually took me quite a few days to finish.
Yeah.
I couldn't finish in a day. It was terrible. It was painfully unfunny. It's basically a film where these black, you know, is making stupid jokes about white people in the film. And then you have that stupid dude that plays the president from that show. What's his name? That Mexican dude?
Oh, George Lopez.
George Lopez is the president. Just, it seemed too fucking cheap.
Yeah.
He's painfully unfunny in it, so.
Yeah, and it didn't help, too, because we also have a cameo from Mike Tyson in the movie, too. And even he wasn't even trying. So the whole cast, every scene was just so obnoxious and just so fucking boring.
And then you have the white guys also throwing racism remarks in there,
yeah,
too.
It's the stereotypical comedy, too, where
spoofs. This is the epiphany. This is why spoofs are done.
They are.
They are fucking dead. Stop them. They need to stop.
Yeah, absolutely. There's this one. And not to mention, we have that stupid running joke where his son is dressed up like a vampire and he thinks he's a vampire.
Vampire? I'm like, that makes no sense.
I know. I'm like, that makes no fucking sense. This fucking joke makes no sense throughout the entire film. Like,
and not only that, it is literally copying, like 50 Shades did. It's literally copying scene for scene of The Purge.
Yeah,
like,
or at least the first one.
The first one, yeah.
Because And it's not, I'm just watching, like, what am I watching? Is this supposed to be a spoof, or is it supposed to be, like, an unofficial entry to The Purge movies? That's what it is. It actually takes place on The Purge.
Yeah.
So I'm like,
it's not even really deeply making fun of The Purge itself. It's throwing comedy of their own, at their own selves, but The Purge part actually feels like a Purge movie.
Yeah.
A really terrible Purge movie.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was my number two in... You know,
that was my number two also, Meet the Blacks.
Right. So, and the number one film for me of 2016 that was the worst piece of shit that I watched was Cell. Written by Stephen King, adapted from Stephen King's work on the novel of the same name, and stars Samuel Jackson and John Cusack in a world where these people that are at this airport, they are on cell phones. These cell phones have some kind of weird way of turning them into these weird kind of zombies where they form in groups. Now, I'll admit, I was kind of looking forward to this film based on the trailers a little bit. I mean, it looked like a typical direct-to-video film, but I still got curious because I did like 1408, and that was another film that starred Samuel Jackson and John Cusack that was also based on Stephen King's work. So it was interesting they brought them three back for this movie because Stephen King actually wrote the screenplay for this one, so it kind of got me curious.
Yeah.
And boy, I've seen a lot of bad adaptations of books, movies, of movies based on books, and a lot of movies that are based on Stephen King's work. And I'll tell you right now, this to me is probably the worst movie that he has ever done, that has ever have any involved with, or anything based on his work. This is the worst one. I mean, you're talking about a film that spends a majority of the movie where John Cusack, who plays a writer, of course, in every Stephen King film, who goes his way to look for his son, and along the way he meets up with Samuel Jackson, and they go on this journey. They go across the fields and everywhere else to try to survive from these zombie-like creatures. And this is the most painfully CGI you would ever imagine in this movie. The opening shot that we see at the airport shows a plane exploding, and you can tell it was not even green screened yet. It was so bad. It looked like, you know, something out of
a lot of Stephen King's movies.
Well, no, it was worse than fucking Langoliers. Remember Langoliers with the meatballs
and The Shining.
The Shining's the remake of The Shining, yeah. The miniseries. Yeah, this one, oh my god, I couldn't find anything redeemable about this movie. There's not good performances. Everyone looks like they're bored as hell. The story was so lackluster, and it's the same kind of story that I've seen. Well, as far as the formula, it's the same formula that I've seen in other zombie films.
Yeah.
In fact, and you know what's even worse is that the fucking action scenes are all fucking shaky cam where you can't see anything. It was so bad, as much as the little parts I saw of World War Z. Yeah. It's that fucking bad. Yeah. And they don't go into any brutality whatsoever with this one. When people are getting killed by the zombies, you see like little, maybe like ketchup blood or something.
It's like very bloodless.
Yeah. I mean, because even when someone's attacking someone, the zombies are kind of covering up where you can't even see what's happening. I'm like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
And not to mention, the opening credits sequence is really bad too. The opening credits, the credits themselves are in like this weird black box that takes up almost half the entire screen. I'm like, what the fuck is that? You can tell that's cheap.
And it's like somebody did it off their computer where you're trying to type words on somebody's picture, and it gives you that starter kit before you see it, and it's like that covers the picture, and it shows the big letters when you accidentally hit too big of a case.
I mean, I guess if it was so bad, so funny on mentality for it, but even that, no, because this movie is so god-awful, I couldn't even put this as a so bad it's funny. And the worst part of it is, the worst CGI I felt was the part where there's this football field that takes place on where the zombies are kind of laying down. Because they have this, inside their mouths, they have this song that's playing where this noise where he's going, la, 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 la. I'm like, oh my god. And yeah, it's very insulting with that. And it was just very obnoxious. And not to mention, it has one of the worst endings I've seen out of a Stephen King movie that makes no sense. And I won't go into what happens, but you talk about an ending where it's not even an ending, it just ends. It's like, no. So, out of Stephen King films, this is the worst one I've ever seen him done. And I actually also heard that supposedly both him and John Cusack, who were involved with the film, there was actually a different rewrite, I think, that came involved with the ending. Because the ending was changed from the book to try to make the ending better. Because a lot of fans who were from the book, they said the ending sucked so bad. So for the film, they had to change it.
Yeah.
But even if the book's ending sucked, I still want to see what it would have been.
I have yet to see it, so I can't really judge the film. But he showed me some clips, and I gotta agree, it's probably really fucking terrible. So
yeah,
and it was it's bad, but
yeah, that's my number one, which was the worst film in my opinion of 2016, which was Cell.
All right, my worst 2016 film was a film he put on his list, but this is absolutely my worst 2016 film, is 50 Shades of Black. Talk about the worst spoof I ever seen in my life. Oh my god, and it's Wayne Brothers again. And this Wayne's, you guys need to stop. It's done. Your careers are finished with these type movies. You're done. You can't live up to Scary Movie. It's over with. These do not live anymore. These can't work anymore. These spoofs are done. They're completely done.
It's like pulling up ash of shit and trying to turn that into something gold.
Yeah. And for everything that was created, like spoofs for its time worked when Scary Movie came out. But because there's been so many of them, it's doing the same shit. It's the exactly. same formula. Not, everything doesn't last forever. So, yeah. Well, it's basically the spoof of Fifty Shades of Grey, which made Fifty Shades of Grey look like an Oscar movie, an Oscar performance movie, which I did not like Fifty Shades of Grey. But I'd watch it over this piece of dog shit.
Yeah.
It was painfully unfunny. That fucking girl that plays Anastasia, whatever her name is, she's busy running in a ship this whole
time. Yeah, I was going to say.
It's like, all right, girl, do you got a goddamn fucking concussion or something? You're bumping into shit every fucking scene.
Yeah, and we all know that joke has been so outdated, but yet they still bring it up in every spoof movie. Yeah.
Marlon Wayans is playing kind of straight, but then again, he's also painfully unfunny, but on some parts, and he just feels annoyed himself.
Yeah,
he doesn't even look
because like he doesn't even try anymore.
He's not even trying. Yeah, exactly. He doesn't even look like he's trying. He's just like throwing lines out. Like, he's bland too in this. And that fat girl, oh my god! Like he said, pluck your eyeballs out because that shit made me feel like I was in Clockwork Orange. Like, I was like, no, help me. Please help me. And I was begging for it to end. This is probably the only movie. Well, I had many films I did this, but I was begging for the credits in the first 5 minutes. I was like, oh my god, this is going to be fucking terrible. Please just say I watched it, but I don't do that. I actually will. Respectfully will finish a film. Oh my god, I took one for the fucking team here. Whoo, it was so fucking painfully unfunny, and I didn't laugh at all. There was nothing. I was just like this.
Yeah, we're not trying to insult anyone who's fat or nothing. We're just saying that the character
I'm not saying so obnoxious. Not, it's a fat girl, I can't remember her name, but she is playing like a raunchy, stereotypical.
Like someone who is obsessed with African American men.
Yeah, and she's drawing it, and that's funny. On some movies, they do that, and it's really funny. But this, the woman that plays her, is just
so. Oh, and what's funny is that's the same girl from Bad Santa too. And that movie, I mean, she was funny in that one.
Yeah, she shockingly, I didn't even recognize her. She was a security guard.
Yeah,
yeah, she was funny in that one. But oh my god, she's just. Talk about getting fucked in the ass and stuff like that. And it's not funny. It's really not funny.
Yeah. It's just... That's one of the examples of what not to do with a spoof anymore. But yeah, if you want to watch a good spoof movie, or at least a recent satire, watch some of the Edgar Wright spoofs like Shaun of the Dead and Hot Fuzz. Or even... Well, I think The World's End was a spoof, but I can't remember.
And the first two scary movies were fucking hilarious.
Yeah, they were.
And in Haunted House... I exceptionally like the first one, not the second one, though. That was a terrible film, but... Yeah, there's some good ones, but a lot of them reside around the early 2000s, mid-2000s, because, like I said, they're overdrawn now.
Yeah.
None of them are good.
But, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Fifty Shades of Black
is my worst film of 2016.
Alrighty, yeah. So now that we've gotten all the shitty bad ones of 2016 out of the way, I'm sure there's going to be some really bad ones this year. Maybe, hopefully, not as bad as last year, at least, but... We're not pushing it anywhere.
And I'm hoping they do better in comedies this year because if you guys pay attention to my list, a lot of it was comedies. I'm not saying I hate comedies. I love comedies. I'm a big comedy fan. It's just they all seem to keep doing the same formula. And it's getting worse and worse and worse and worse.
So I'm saying there's...
Hopefully they do better in comedies this year.
I know. I'm hoping so because all the shit that we had last year, other than a few of them, we had some pretty bad ones.
Yeah.
So...
Anyways,
we thank you so much, y'all, for watching our best and worst of 2016. And if you have any recommendations or if you have any lists that you have in mind, comment below and let us know what y'all's top 10 best and worst movies were. And if you guys like what you see here, you can check out more of our reviews here. And we'll be seeing you in our next review. We'll see you later.
Later.